Tony, I want to start with the speech you made before you went to the Hall of Fame here in town, and you mentioned you got to have the guts to chase your dream. And if winning a World Series championships is chasing that dream and getting that dream, what does it mean to you, Oakland, two championships in St. Louis, intrinsically, emotionally, when you achieve that dream? What does it mean to you?
Well, you know, you're a product of how you were raised, great parents. My mom gave me the gift of reading. You know, books are some of my best friends. I love to read. And I thank her for introducing me. My dad, he's a dreamer. You know, we lived in an area that produced Al Lopez. My dad knew Al Lopez, loved baseball. Hotbed of baseball lore. Lou Piniella's come from there. And now Luis Gonzalez, you know, Tino Martinez. I mean, you know, Fred McGriff. So as a kid, dream, man. Dream, dream, dream. Make them big. Don't make them unreachable because you'll get frustrated. So as a ball player, what are you going to do? You want to play in the big leagues and you'll be part of a world champion. Now the dream is that you're actually getting hit in the ninth inning like Luis did. But to be on that team in Oakland and then in St. Louis, they come true. That's why you dream. So I think one of the important things that I like to say, and I've said it several times here since I've been with the Diamondbacks, that the fans need to hear. There ain't anything about my past that makes me comfortable or satisfied. It just gets me more excited. And an opportunity to do something different, which is be part of the front office and produce a championship in Arizona, has got me totally psyched up, just like I did those years. So I can see now Dave Duncan. You know, I know where Derek and Kim come from and the other owners. 98 losses was bitter, but it's going to make the winning sweeter.
You know, you mentioned Al Lopez and the Go-Go Sox. I remember interviewing him back in the 80s. He had such a positive attitude. I felt like I was at, you know, some kind of motivational speech. He had a unique knack. And then I remember interviewing Mike Vec about his dad, Bill. And he said something interesting. When Bill won the championship with the 48 Cleveland team, he said, it's an old Sicilian saying, you work a lifetime to become an overnight success. He said it was a short euphoria.
Right.
And then it was back to the grind. Did you find that to be the case?
Oh, sure. I mean, John Madden one time, you know, we won in 83 to 84. We had a tough year. Went home. And, you know, I had the pleasure of living in the Bay Area. You know, I developed a friendship with Bill Wallace, John Madden, these legends. And they feed you all this stuff. And you make the notes, man. And pretty soon it's who you are. And John said, when they won with the Raiders, the next year we had a tough year. He says, made a mistake. The next year we started where we ended. What does that mean? He says, the first year of the championship, they started at zero, putting it all together, the frame of mind, the ABCs of the fundamentals, the offensive and defensive plan. The next year, they started where they ended. And it's a big mistake. So you enjoy the moment and you relish it, you know, the championship, but I guarantee you, the other 29 teams, the minute that thing is over, they're planning on unseating you. So it's absolutely imperative that you get to zero to start. And that's when you have a great year. When you have a tough year like this one, we need to get to zero as well. I mean, like right now, we're tied for first place because you don't want to walk in there and, you know, all discouraged and, you know, have a pall around our fans and our organization. We start at zero, and it's frame of mind controls a lot of what you do.
Last night, I'm listening to your narration on the 25 years of the earthquake.
I didn't see it.
Oh, man, good? It was really well done. It was emotional at times to realize what that city went through. But what I find interesting is that if you look at how dominating your A's team, you know, four straight wins, you win the series, but the quake kind of filled the room, so to speak, in terms of the news around that series. How did you assimilate that?
One thing we didn't do was that we didn't elevate what we were doing competitively in sports with the real life tragedies. You know, we paid proper respects, you know, losses of life, property. I mean, it disrupted many, many things. But I know when it was interrupted, there was some talk about canceling the World Series. And we said, oh, wait, and some of our guys started feeling guilty. I said, wait a minute. They're playing pro football and college football. They're having the plays, comedy shows. I mean, that's all entertainment. So whenever it's candlestick's ready to go, we're going to play, and we should So what we did was, that was really, Jude, you're talking about, I'd fall asleep during a game and somebody nudged me, well, what is it, power, push the button, pitch it. I mean, it was ridiculous how good that team was. So our concern, you know, when you have, it's like a track coach at the Olympics. You know, you have a great world champion and you coach, and you want them peaking at the Olympic moment, right? That team peaked in the last, you know, by the 1st of September. Because we had a real good challenge with the Angels that year. We didn't win until about the last 10 days. But, man, we came into that thing. Our pitchers were pitching. Ricky and our hitters were playing. We always had a defensive, Carney Lansford, you know, Walt Weiss. These guys were killers on defense. Dave Enders. So we go in there, and it's a real good Giants team. They had a very good offense team like ours. Their pitching was hurt. So we were healthier. It gave us an edge. But we win the first two games. And all of a sudden, and then you're thinking, now you got to get over the guilt, you know, the tragedies around you. When we resume play, it's one thing that we had learned. The first thing that you need to coach is the heart and the minds of your players. So before you ever get to, hey, this is how we're going to hit, whoever the pitcher was coming back, Kelly Downs, whoever it was, we're going to make sure that our heads and our hearts are where they're supposed to be and where they were before the earthquake. And the way we did that was one thing. We took a trip to Arizona just to get away from it, and just and we were celebrated by 8,000 fans.
I remember that.
And that was really it was a reminder to us that, you know, it's still a game. We're two wins away from the World Series, and it refreshed us.
That was a powerhouse team. And then you go to St. Louis in 06. You have this knack of these, I don't want to call them underdog players, but David Eckstein kind of comes out of nowhere, 0-for-11 initially, and then on fire becomes the series MVP, and you win your first one in St. Louis.
Well, you take that, and you take 2011, David Freese against Philadelphia, struck out 5 out of the first 6 times, and goes on to be the MVP of the championship series and World Series. So, you know, one thing you learn, and this is why the most exciting and fun time you can have is to be in October playoff baseball. And we've had our heartbreaks. You know, we got swept in 04 by the Red Sox, got lost to the Dodgers. We had it hard. But you need to recognize that if you're good enough to get into the playoffs, you're good enough to win it. And it's just a real crapshoot. So, you know, we've had the 100-win team that got beat. But what's most important is that at that moment, head and heart, right? The guys' heads are totally into the urgency of the competition. Their hearts are pounding. Their guts are going. And you don't allow any distractions. And if you can do that, it's like I've seen the playoffs. There's some really good series. Like Baltimore has got it going. Kansas City's got it going. Kansas City's barely winning. Baltimore ain't doing anything wrong. But Kansas City's been a little bit better. And what happened in 06 for us in 11 was that it was our time. And once we grabbed it right here, we just grabbed it by the neck and finished it off.
This franchise has had success. I don't think anybody alive will ever forget the 2001 World Series and the drama around the tragedy of 9/11. What's your message to the fans? Because people want to taste that flavor of victory again.
What a great question, because I'll give them a reminder. Remember who they beat in the division series, the St. Louis Cardinals. And we had a hellacious 5-game series. It started here where Kurt beat Morris 1-0. Then we won the second game, lost game 3, we won game 4. So we come back for game 5. And I can remember, because later on when it got to the World Series, I was here for one of those games. And I remember game 5, the fever, the passion in this building, fans going nuts. And game 5, they delivered a 2-1 dramatic win. Womack got the base hit.
Yep.
And how could you forget winning 6 and then game 7 beating Mariano? I mean, so what I'm trying to say is that's what's the potential. That's what's possible. And I know that this whole community beyond the greater Arizona area, everybody celebrated it. And that's exactly what our dream is to reinstill that interest and passion from our fans. I know you got to earn it. I know it's a difficult area because we got people that have moved from all over and they have their favorite teams, but I've talked to a bunch of them since I've been here. There are a bunch of them say, hey, you know, I'm from the East and I'm a Red Sox or Yankees, But I can love the Diamondbacks too. So what we got to do is remind them that it's here, and it's up to us in the Diamondbacks shirts and uniforms to produce the kind of baseball that gets them excited, gets them feeling like they can be playing October again. And I'm telling you, Jude, the commitment of this organization, from everybody I see, from the ownership through, even to the minor leagues, five teams make the playoffs. This is a very, very healthy situation, and we're going to be in contention sooner rather than later.
Well, it's an exciting time. It's with you and what you've done in baseball, I think fans are curious and optimistic and hopeful that the future bodes well.
I will add to one thing. I think that we're going to have a very strong front office team, including all the scouts, player development. I think we're going to have a great support system. But I will tell you that the pressure, the expectations are going to be translated to Chip, the coaches, and the players. And they're going to be the ones in the fire in the battle. We're going to support them as best we can. But believe me, I know the strength of Chip already. I know the quality of our coaches. They're going to pull it off, like I say, sooner rather than later.
Do you see a little bit of yourself in him in a sense that he was kind of a utility infielder, a guy that grinded away, paid his dues, waited for his break, also was mentored by some real notables in the game?
I think there are similarities. It's clear he loves the game. Look at all the dues he's paid, minor league manager, coaching, raising the Twins organization. I think there are a lot of similarities, love of the game, the learning. He was a lot better player than I was. And so I pay my respects to him. When we talk about teaching the game, I'll listen to him more than I listen to me.
Tony, thanks for your time, man.
Anytime, dude. Always a pleasure, man.